Oh, I know. If you can prove you're an alien, I'll come over and help you out. Do you want me to say more alien things? No, I mean, I have no way to verify if those are true or not. Oh, send me a picture of you. I don't have any photos with me. And anyway, how could I get it to you? I'm trapped in here by that monster. Aren't you using the Tetrax tablet? Take the pics with that and transmit it over. Pictures, transmit. Okay, that's kind of a weird ask, Xerox. But I'll give it a shot. Here goes. Selfie time? Oh my god, a selfie in the 90s. Oh, I didn't look at everything in that room yet. Your name is Xefros Trito. You are having a difficult evening, just one of many, in a predictably difficult life because you are rust-blood trash. Jeez. You just witnessed beams of red and green energy erupt from the hive of your best friend, Tetrakdamic, right before a squadron of Imperial drones snatched up half of your neighbors, so it's safe to say your revolutionary efforts are not going great. Oh, and it seems you've received a package. What's this? As a rustblood, you are gifted with telekinesis, the ability to move objects with your mind. Huh. Gifted is in quotes because you're being kind of sarcastic about your powers being so weak. Okay. Doors. Thing. Tetrakdamic says your really infrequent and unreliable omni-scuttle coach schedule is symptomatic of an infrastructure engineered to prevent cast mobility. And since you nod while he says it, he hasn't explained what that means. I use touch telekinesis? Guess not. Tetrakdamic's hive. You hope he's in one of the parts that hasn't been annihilated by massive beams of light. You'd never use your psychic powers on a Tetrak's hive. The heiress just launched a new carbonated hydration juice flavor, Claw Gunk. You're required to buy whatever she's selling or be cold anyway, so you're not sure why she bothers advertising. Now this thing said it was a troll? Why bother to fail? Those billboards are everywhere. It's a delivery from Scythian, with the item you ordered quite a long time ago. You guess it arrived during all the confusion. So quiet, no music. You shouldn't draw attention to yourself right now. Weakly wobble the box later. You open up the package. Inside is a FLARP manual. This edition of FLARP is focused on spy games, intrigue, and rebellion. Tetrakdamic modeled a lot of his underground resistance ideas after this system. Wow, he like really got along with Jude. Greetings, Agent. The documents in this file detail your objectives, page 3, and protocols, page 7. You must work, page 19, remotely, page 22, with your team, page 44 of Elite, page 59, Agents, page 399, to covertly, page 2050, infiltrate page 99, the... Okay, you don't have time for all this right now. Or ever, really. Playing FLARP was Tetrakdamic's idea. Most things are. Claw Gunk would be a good name for a FLARP villain. She'd be a vicious, totalitarian, fuchsia-blooded megalomaniac, And you think you suddenly understand why so many flop writers get called. All right. You got the flop manual? Better head inside. Not much you can do for the Tetrarch out here. You've kind of outgrown flarp, but no returns for Rustbloods. The door to your respite block, where you sleep. You're standing on your gander precipice. Gander precipice. Music! This leads to your gander precipice. Many a fine gander you've had out there. Good, honest gandering. I got all this stuff. You use these to practice your budding powers of telekinesis. You still aren't very good yet, but you sure showed these spoons who's boss. By defeating this pile of silver spoons, you've gained... Let's see. Nope, you've actually lost a bunch of experience points, since the spoons are less valuable now than they were before. Whoops. Yes, that's right. Practice makes almost adequate. That's the burgundy way. Your mind flexes with the pulsing might of your phenomenal telekinetic powers, and you bend a tiny little silver spoon without even using your grubby little fingers. Big tough guy. Better bring this along just in case you run into any bent soup. Bent spoon? Let's see. Oh, okay. Spoon bent. See utensil. Alright. Utensil. See tool. Tool. See weapon. Okay. Weapon is listed on just about every page. Ugh. Why is the index in this thing so terrible? You already bent this rusty little guy as far as you can. Any further and you'll break him. This ordinary spoon is all bent up from your telekinetic training. Maybe you could even try bending it back to normal? No, impossible. You're not even remotely prepared to attempt that. It's absolutely permitted for you to use your real-life telekinesis in a FLARP session. Of course, yours is so pitifully weak that it's not like it was going to be unfair advantage any way you sliced it. Might as well hold on to this one. Who knows, it might come in handy in some kind of semi-contrived fashion. You play pusher, of course. Burgundies are ideally suited to their position because of their telekinetic powers and their ability to commune with dead players. Also, pusher is the most dangerous position, and no one really cares if Rustbloods get killed. Nice. Yeah, you were good enough telekinetic to bend spoons, but not really good enough for it to be an asset on the Velvet. The FLARP manual doesn't contain any mechanics for interacting with your poster. You would demand a refund if such uppity impertinence from a Rustblood wouldn't get you killed. You managed to hang this poster without using your telekinesis. Or, you guess what you mean is, it would have been cool to hang this poster using your telekinesis, but your telekinesis is very weak, and that frame was sort of heavy, kind of. You're reminded of the weak Tetrarch Damic made you sleep on the floor as a training exercise. It was hard at first, and maybe could have told you it was a training exercise beforehand, instead of just saying, sleep on the floor until I tell you otherwise. But it really toughened you up. You can sleep anywhere now. The Tetrarch is always making sure you're prepared for anything. You're not supposed to eat the Sorper Slime, which is easy because, gross, why would you want to? Some FLARP manuals contain optional rule sets for fatigue mechanics. You think that sounds exhausting. This is roughly around when you might normally be going to sleep, but the current circumstances, i.e. your imminent death if you don't escape, are not conducive to sleep. They are conducive to dying, though. Okay. What we got here? Your where grid study scroll. To be honest, only indigos really care about what fork goes where, and they crush anything they pick up anyway. It doesn't match any of the spoons on the poster, not anymore. You just slip this bad boy under the table at some high society dinner and watch all the blue bloods squirm. That would be a really funny thing to see immediately before being executed. You suppose the knives in your silverware set could do some serious damage. Too bad you're only comfortable handling the spoons. Some butlers are so skilled at telekinesis that they're able to set entire tables at once. Every rake, prong, and bile scooper in exactly the right place. It's still pretty awful. You can't get excited about the butler life no matter how hard you try. Okay. So, a book here. And balloons or something? Lights? Arena stickball has always been the only time you really feel like yourself. When you're out on the velvet, you're a brawler defending you against the opposing prowlers and zappers, and you're just thinking about it makes you... Thinking about too much makes you a little sad now. Looking at the dozer always helps you get to sleep, and looking at the snow globe always makes you nervous. You know it's not a real one, but still. A snow globe? Sounds like a great way to electrocute yourself. You keep that in mind in case a less painful death beat seems unavoidable. What a daring dream. To swing from your sports-themed chandelier and, land on your bed, you guess? This is a pretty meager role-play experience. You let the dream die. You attempt to wrench loose the chandelier with a devastating blast of telekinetic might. You fail to succeed, but you do succeed to fail. That's one way of looking at it. What's this? White gloves, shoe polish, training silverware. Everything an involuntary, aspiring butler needs. You've already tidied your butler training manuals, even the ones you need use to tidy the other ones. That's that, okay. Not much you can do with it in high society now, unless you can pay it off as a chitin scraper or something. You don't need any help from Flarp to imagine what it would be like to have to train as a butler. All you need is your imagination and the brutal limiting caste system which prevents you from realistically pursuing any other path in life. Sounds horrible. Can't do? Alright. Alright. Well, that's that. Oh hey, it's your arena stickball gear. You play pusher. It brings back fond memories of your seasons playing in the Outglut Grub League. You're looking out. You're trying out for the Thrash Thrush Junior League soon, but you're a little rusty. Get it? Rust blood? If you blow it, you could get cold. Between band practice with Tetrac Demic, revolution lectures from Tetrac Demic, and butling practice, you mostly serve Tetrac Demic, you really haven't had the time you need to practice. Speaking of, there's your brand new butler uniform. It brings back less than fond memories of when you ordered it, sweeps ago. Delivery to the Rust Bloods like you is so slow. And hey, there's your smash suit, from when the Tetrarch helped you practice cool action movie stunts. Your memory from that time is a little hazy, actually. This bent spoon won't give you any trouble. As evidenced by your clothes, you have no problem with unconventional taste. All your outfits grant various stat bonuses in Flarp, of course. They also come with heavy stat penalties, usually, always in your case, outweighing the bonuses. Well, that sucks. Okay, so we can look at that. You could lightly jostle your clothes on their hangers, but it doesn't sound to be worth the nosebleed. You never forget the season your arena stickball team took third place in the Outglut Grub League. But just in case you do, this featureless white orb is here to remind you. Nothing? Nothing? Nothing. Okay. Every low blood who ever picked up a mic dreams of competing on Slammed or Get Cold. The winner leaves their unhappy life behind for fame, fortune, and the love of millions. The losers leave their unhappy lives behind for relatively certain death. Jeez. It looks like American Idol, huh? This slammer at cold poster does kind of look like someone about to take a big bite of grub flex. You're not sure which of these fantasies is more unrealistic. Powerful psychic lowbloods sometimes use their abilities to spice up their stage presence, something you've been unable to do with any degree of success. It doesn't really get the crowd on their feet to bend a spoon with your mind, and then pass out. It's your tablet. You use it for pretty much everything. Your auto-tune mic is plugged into it. Okay, before I mess with the tablet, let me just look at the stuff. I don't know. You use it for pretty much all computing needs. Perfect device for a kid on the go, except you spend most of your time at home, so it usually just stays right here in your room. Unfortunately, a kid on the go is probably exactly what you are now. You really should grab it. Besides, your mic is plugged into it, and you're sure not leaving that behind. That looks like a mouse with caterpillar legs. Oh, same. Okay, I'm gonna get that in a little bit. Actually, I'm gonna get it now. You gather both tablet and mic with one practice motion. They're attached, so the motion probably didn't require as much practice as you might think. You then proceed to have this conversation again from the other side. It's all news to Xefros, but it'd be a little dull to read the whole thing over again. Let's just pick up where we left off. Okay. So Joey said, do you want me to say more alien things? No, I mean, I have no way to verify if those are true or not. Send me a picture of you. Nice selfie. Oh yeah, you're definitely an alien. Or you have some strange collection of grotesque physical and mental diseases. Either way, you need my help. Okay, that much is definitely true. I'm pretty sure I heard that monster scratching at the door. He's probably hungry. Anyway, man, if you're an alien, we've got to get you out of here. The heiress hates aliens. Sigh. The what? The heiress. Well, she's awful and controls everything, basically. I mean, I doubt she's ever met one. But to hear her talk, she hates aliens as much as she hates lowbloods. Which I guess you also are. You're practically a member of the Resistance already. I'm not sure whether to be really confused or really concerned about you. Do you need help? One time when things got really bad with my brother, my babysitter took him to the doctor and it seemed to help. What's a doctor? Well, and I thought my home life was neglectful. Okay, I'm definitely concerned. Being concerned is what friends do for each other. I've never had anyone but Tetrarch Damoc be concerned about me before. Oh, jeez. I bet the other Tetrarchs would be extremely excited to hear there's an alien helping us now. Sure. But I'm sort of pretty focused on not being killed by the monster in the other room at the moment. That's kind of my main deal right now. I don't really have a lot of time for anything else. Right. Yeah, of course. I'll help you. And the Tetrarch, too, because, well, I think... Okay, I hope this is also helping him somehow. Which reminds me, we really shouldn't be talking like this. Like what? Tetrarch Damoc says we always have to assume our communications are being monitored. This is exactly the kind of conversation I shouldn't be having. Oh man, I better hurry up and get over there. On my way now. Please don't message me anymore. It's dangerous. Be right back. In person, I mean. Further communication will put you and Joey Alien at even greater risk. Wow. You shouldn't even be thinking about stuff with the psychics the heiress has at her command. It's better to maintain radio silence for now. Okay, so I took that stuff. The grubbles, if you buck, we won't trouble to resist drawing fists while you sift through the rubble. It's sort of hard to spit your quasi-revolutionary rhymes with any real fire while dressed in your butler uniforms, though. Demick says you're subversively transforming the rags of your oppression into the fatigues of the revolutionary through your jams, but you're kind of worried your performances will be drowned out by sarcastic orders to polish the silver. All that's missing is some batteries. Well, and your band leader, and some fans, and your better songs, honestly, and a means of monetizing your brand, which, if you're being frank, could also use some polish. This bent spood would be a perfect element to incorporate into your rebellious service class aesthetic. If it makes you blush to think about, but your flarp character was going to be in a band too, one with two Demics. The tiny rips your measly powers can actually produce would complement your anarchic aesthetic without sacrificing readability. Okay. I think I could switch at any time. Out. So let's try this on stuff. Both of these mouse-centric tools are broken. Both of them. Neither works. Hey, aren't you supposed to be saving someone's life right now? Or were you the one being saved? You can't precisely remember, but you rest assured that the confusion will last only for the duration of your attempt to use these items together. The Espia Crooner class is extremely difficult at the lower levels, and well, at all levels, really. It's a stealth and stinging class, not a particularly harmonious pairing. Okay. Okay. Stuff. Maybe you actually have a better shot of getting on the show if you didn't use the mic Damick made. You couldn't do that to him, though. Like, he would physically prevent you from doing that. He can be pretty forceful. Nothing? Okay. Oh, I don't want to do that. Now's probably not the time to get dressed for a performance, which is to say you really don't feel like putting on your butler uniform. Okay, I just noticed finally he has the same shirt. The symbol is the same. If you get it near the supper slime, it might get ruined. Should we sleep in that thing? Maybe you actually have a better shot of getting on the show if you didn't use the... Oh. Same thing. Same... Alright. You're still working on your set list. This thing. You haven't had as much time to practice since Demick got you to join the Grubbles, or since he got you to join his rebellion. But hey, it's important to support your friend's interests. Okay. Band practice with Tetrarch Demick has significantly reduced your time for butler training. So it's pretty fair to say that Tetrarch Damick is actually the dominant friend here. With all those drones out there? No way. We can't open that now. Alright. Otherwise I'd mess with this stuff out there. But thankfully, I can just go through here. Sheesh. There's like so much text in this game. You kind of wish you could live somewhere with more trees, and maybe then he'd be less asleep always? Like most things in your life, though, you didn't really have much say in the matter. Who's he? Tetrarch Damick had you act out scenes from some of your favorite action movies, which just so happened to be his favorite action movies, too. You're lucky to have a Moirail who really pushes you. This is from the 12th Peregrine's Eve when Damick gave you the autotune mic he made. This was his way of letting you know he'd started a band and that you were the singer, and also that your voice could use a little help. You still can't believe they got a shot of you at the exact moment you clobbered the clover. What a lucky break. Sweet. squeaky. The door to the Lucius shed, or your Lucius shed where your Lucius sleeps, in theory. In practice, though, he sleeps wherever the hell he wants, sometimes in a branch, sometimes in less convenient places. Okay, is that the Lucius? He'd be less asleep. If there were less trees, he wouldn't be sleeping as much, okay. There are way less gross places to clean a bent spoon. Even if this auto-tune mic were waterproof, you doubt there's any undiscovered talent lurking in the depths of your nasty bucket. Are these different things? It's just your faithful old scour tray, which you haven't bothered draining recently. Inside of it, resin fluid and floor filth coalesce to make a repugnant gray sludge. Okay, that's the door, and this is his thing. Be careful with that thing, alright? It's common knowledge that FLARP manuals have an inherent -50 resistance rating against scour dray resin fluid. The last time you attempted to pull this stunt, you accidentally tipped the bucket and spilled scour dray resin fluid all over the place. Your skills haven't improved much since then, so you better move along before you make another mess. Okay. What's at the end here? I guess this is the door we came through? Let me just see. Yes. More posters here. Aw, he's cute. Haha, he was always giving you leaves to eat. You would munch on them for his benefit, mostly. Come to think of it, though, you have always been pretty strong. Could those bitter leaves you gnawed on as a wiggler have something to do with that? When you were just a little wiggler, curling up with your Lucius made you feel safe when the world seemed scary, which was often. Jeez, come to think of it, the two of you haven't played on the tree in a long time. Maybe that's why he's been so lazy? Well, at least it looks like the two of you will both be getting some exercise in the immediate future. How much longer does this game go on for? Look. Cleaning supplies, the noble instruments of your future career. What's it say? I guess? You guess. It kind of depresses you to keep them anywhere you'd like to have fun, so you just dump them at the end of the hallway. Just looking at your cleaning supplies dredges up enough emotion to inspire you to sing an impressively angsty power ballad, but your auto-tune mic's current battery situation won't allow it. Cleaning supplies are mostly meant to be used on things that don't go in your mouth. Your FLARP manual really has no place among the cleaning supplies. Ideally, you'd be able to kick back in an easy chair while using the power of your mind to get these cleaning supplies sweeping and scrubbing on your behalf, but you couldn't telekinesis your way out of a wet chitin sack. Is that what I did with that? Maybe if your hallway is really clean, the drones will stop trying to burn your neighborhood down and kill you? Ah, there's your rust blood, Moxie. More posters. More pictures. Your Tetrarch plays lead drums when you guys perform. You didn't know that lead drums were a thing until Damek told you he was playing them and that you were in a band with him. In contrast to Tetrarch Damek's percussive machismo, your stage persona is more skittish, as if you're vaguely terrified of the implications of your own pseudo-revolutionary rhymes. Which is not far off the mark, as one of the implications could be your execution. This was a great night. Damek insisted you have half the flavor disc. Your Lucius took this picture, a delightful trick he has never repeated. You guys have a lot of fun in the studio, as evidenced by this candid selfie Tetrarch Damek told you to take. Look at you, so careless. So carefree. You wish you were gearing up to play right now. You were so excited to show him that branch. He ate all the leaves in one very slow bite, and you were left with a pretty decent hive-made cubat. The first cubat you ever had, actually. Okay, so that's why this is called Hiveswap, because they call this place the Hive. Your smear spinner has gotten a lot of use lately. Why, just look at that even glisten of mucus on the floor. Beautiful. You could almost take pride in it. This is, seems so, like, clean, though. It's really dirty. You laid out some verse about how the smear spinner keeps everything shiny and smooth, but it also impedes mobility. It's pretty tight, the way you manage to poetically associate the more abstract elements of your class struggle with this concrete visible object, such that it serves as a potent metaphor both for your oppression and your forced participation in keeping that oppression running smoothly. You also say some light cusses. Okay, oh, this bent spoon will not make a useful smear spinner accessory. You're a little embarrassed that you even tried to do that. Would it be classified as a vehicle or familiar? Maybe as an enemy? No. No, it would never turn on you like that. The smear spinner glides so easily across the floor, you're sometimes actually able to move it with your puny telekinesis. Alright. Not going downstairs, let's go here. The door to your rumpus room. Oh god, more stuff.